All right, today I want to do just a quick little study here on tracting, putting out gospel tracts. And I believe that there are basically two different types of tracting that you can do. And the one would be evangelistic tracting, and the other would be accountability tracting. Now, that might seem kind of strange. You might say, well, what on earth are you talking about? I just thought tracting is tracting. Well, I'm going to show you there's a difference between the two. And I'm going to get into that today. First, we're going to talk about evangelistic tracting. Now, what we're going to do today is we're going to do just a quick study on the book of Acts, not the whole way through, because that would take quite a long while. But I just want to read some verses here to show you sort of the different spirit in people and how that a lot of times that can change the way that you are ministering to them. Now, when did the church actually start? When did the, when did everything really get underway is what I'm trying to say. Well, the book of Acts, there are the Acts of the Apostles. After the crucifixion and the resurrection, when Jesus went back up to heaven, he gave them the great commission to go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. All right, so after Jesus went back up to heaven in Acts chapter 1, you can read about that. The Holy Ghost came on the day of Pentecost, and it was only on that day of Pentecost, not the day of Pentecost every year. So to name your denomination Pentecostal is kind of a dumb thing to do. I've covered that in other studies. But we see the progression in the book of Acts. And I just want to say that the book of Acts is a transition book. You can't go to the first part of the book of Acts and take that, you know, Acts chapter 2 specifically. A lot of people try to make that their main doctrine for today. That doesn't work. Things have changed since Acts chapter 2. They were first going to the Jews. They really weren't messing around with the Gentiles very much. We're going to see that in the study today. But just want to show you the atmosphere there that was present at that early church, the condition there among the people. So we're going to start reading here. Acts chapter 2, verse 6. It says here, now when this was noised abroad, the fact that the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they began to speak in other tongues, also known as languages. When this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded, because that every man heard them speak in his own language. You see it there. Tongues are languages. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? And how hear we every man in our own tongue wherein we were born? Parthians and Medes and Elamites and the dwellers in Mesopotamia and in Judea and in Cappadocia, in Pontus, in Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, in Egypt and in the parts of Libya about Cyrene, and strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes, Cretes and Arabians, we do hear them speak in our tongues the wonderful works of God. And they were all amazed and were in doubt, saying one to another, what meaneth this? Others, mocking, said, these men are full of new wine. But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judea, and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words. Notice there in verse 13 of Acts chapter 2, they mocked the Holy Ghost gift of, the real Holy Ghost gift of speaking in other tongues. And yet Peter didn't stand up and say, why, you've blasphemed the Holy Ghost. He didn't do that. Okay, that we have real speaking in tongues, not the fake stuff that the charismatics do, but real speaking in tongues, and the people are mocking him. And Peter says, just hold on a second, let me preach to you. You know, hearken to my words. See, this modern charismatic thing of you make fun of somebody that's blibbering and blabbering, and they say, you've blasphemed the Holy Ghost. That has no basis in Scripture. They made that whole thing up, just like they make their tongues up. But we're not going to go through all that Peter preached to them. We're going to go to where he finishes preaching. Acts chapter 2, verse 36. Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly, let all the what? The house of Israel. As I said earlier, they were speaking to the Jews at first. They were not preaching to the Gentiles. says here, Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ. Verse 37. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart, and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, Men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Did you know that there are whole denominations that base their salvation on Acts chapter 2, verse 38? They say salvation is repenting and being baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. That's not the plan of salvation for today. All right? You say, well, then it was a false gospel. No, the gospel was not fully revealed until Paul came along. But you see, the gospel had to first be preached to the Jews, and the word was to be confirmed with signs following. We're going to see that here in just a little bit. That was what was going on there in the first century, right after Jesus Christ went back up to heaven. Go to the Jews and confirm the word with signs following. That's what's going on. Acts chapter 2, verse 38 is not our gospel today. All right, you are not going to be saved if you repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. All right, you are to believe, you are to call upon the name of the Lord to be saved. And you are to believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. So watch out for people trying to get you back to Acts chapter 2. The book of Acts is a transition book. That's so important to remember. But let's continue here. Acts chapter 2, verse 39. For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, Save yourselves from this untoward generation. Then they that gladly received his word, that's going to be important there, were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking of bread, and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. Can you do wonders and signs today? Some people would want you to believe that yes, they can, but the fact is all they can do is fake the signs and wonders. Or if there is some kind of thing that happens, a lot of times I believe it's a demonic manifestation. Again, that's been covered in other studies. Verse 44, And all that believed were together and had all things common, and sold their possessions and goods, and parted them to all men, as every man had need. And they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Now I want to make a few points here. As I said earlier, the gospel was not fully revealed. All right, it did not. The gospel that we currently preach was not revealed until Paul showed up. Now that doesn't mean that the people in the early part of the book of Acts were not saved and that they're part of a different body of Christ than we are today. That's nonsense. That's hyper-dispensationalism. All right. They were saved. Paul writes about in Romans chapter 16, I believe it is, he writes about that there were these other brethren that were in Christ, he says, before me. So yes, there were. See if I can get the verse here quick. Romans chapter 16, verse 7. Salute Andronicus and Junia, my kinsmen and my fellow prisoners, who are of note among the apostles, who also were in Christ before me. All right, the body of Christ did not start with the apostle Paul. That's one of the errors that the hyper-dispensationalists make. Yes, they preached a different plan of salvation back here in the early part of the book of Acts, but it wasn't that God then had to put them into another body or something like that. That's just heretical. Another point I want to make is Peter didn't give out the word in a written form like you would with tracting, but he did quote scripture. You can read about that, the verses I skipped over there in Acts chapter 2. Another point I want to make is that these people gladly received the word. Now that's very important. You see, there are places in this world today where you can go with gospel tracts and the people will gladly receive the word. They want to hear it. And if you are listening to this message and you are living in the UK or the United States or up in Canada, you know that there are very few places where the people will gladly receive the word. Most often what will happen is the people will see your tracts or take your tract and they will rip it up and throw it in the garbage. Okay, they're not gladly receiving the word of God. So evangelistic tracting is going to be very difficult in a place where people are very hard-hearted to the gospel. What you're going to have there is accountability tracting. I don't want to get ahead of myself here in this study, but the point is, there are places still in this world. If you go to China, I know a brother over in India, Lordson Rock. He's a pastor over there. He had a chance to go to Nepal. And, I mean, you ought to see the pictures. I mean, people just crowding in the churches to hear him preach. You wouldn't have that here. People, you know, with their hands out, you know, begging, please give me a tract, give me a tract. That's what was going on there in Acts chapter 2. They were saying, please, we want to hear, what men and brethren, what must we do to be saved? You know, we want to be saved. See, that's a situation where your tracting is being done for evangelism. And a lot of people will get saved at that point. They had 3,000 saved there in Acts chapter 2. But another point I'm going to make is that we read there in Acts chapter 2, the Jewish apostles were dealing with Israel, so signs and wonders were being performed. All right. Matthew chapter 16, verse 20 says, and they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. Amen. All right, that was their instructions. They were supposed to go out. The apostles were given certain supernatural powers at first to go out and perform miraculous signs and wonders. These weren't faked tongues or paying somebody to come and act like they've been healed when they haven't. That wasn't what was going on here. They were laying hands on the sick and the sick were recovering. It wasn't the sick had to have enough faith and provide a seed gift and all this other stuff and then maybe eventually they'll get healed. No, they were laying their hands on them and boom, they were recovering. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 22 says, for the Jews require a sign and the Greeks seek after wisdom. It was perfectly fine for the Jews to require signs and wonders to confirm the word. Why? Well, you go back through the Old Testament, God was continually confirming things with signs and wonders. All right, so it was not a bad thing that they were doing there in Acts chapter 2. But is this for today? As I said before, no, it isn't. And the charismatic crazies out there, they can't perform any real miracles. They just fake the things. All right, that's what's going on. But notice, too, in Acts chapter 2, verse 47, it says that the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Now, that's important to keep in mind. You see, it's not about predestination or anything like that where God has pre-chosen those who will be saved and those who are going to be lost have no chance of getting saved. That isn't what's going on there. The fact of the matter is, though, it is up to God whether or not he's going to save somebody. God knows the heart. And there's an awful lot of people that will pray a quote-unquote sinner's prayer, and they don't really mean it. They haven't come to a place where they see themselves as sinners. They're not willing to live for the Lord. They're not willing, they haven't come to the end of themselves, to the end of their own self-righteousness. They just want to pray this prayer so they can get in on the good stuff. Well, I'm afraid that doesn't work. And God is the one that looks and he sees, okay, that person right there, they're sincere. Yes, I'll save them. All right, I will purchase them with the blood that I shed on the cross. And it was God's blood, by the way. So basically, your tracting efforts, if you go out and do tracting, are effortless. You're just useless. No, I'm sorry, not effortless. But your tracting efforts are useless if God's not in it. If God's not behind what you're doing, you're just wasting your time. All right? It's very important to remember. Now we're going to go to Acts chapter 8, verses 3 through 6. See another interesting thing here. This is right after Acts chapter 7, where Stephen is stoned to death for preaching. And Saul, who later becomes Paul, is standing there and he sees Stephen being killed. But Acts chapter 8, verse 3, "As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering into every house, and hailing men and women, committed them to prison. Therefore they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria, and preached Christ unto them, and the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did." Again, he's going to Samaria there, which they were kind of a part Jewish. Again, I can't get into all that, but he was going there and he was preaching the word and the people were gladly receiving it. Again, they wanted to hear. And so there was a door opened there to Philip, and he went and he was going and he was preaching to these people and they were gladly receiving the word. So the tracting, quote unquote, that he was doing, the preaching the word, was actually leading to the salvation of souls. All right. Acts chapter 11, verse 19. We'll read down through here. Another couple interesting things. "Now they which were scattered abroad upon the persecution that arose about Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, preaching the word to none but the Jews only." You see? What I'm saying, they're just preaching to the Jews. This is to the house of Israel. But now you're going to start to see the transition. Acts chapter 11, verse 20. "And some of them were men of Cyprus and Cyrene, which, when they were come to Antioch, spake unto the Grecians, preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number believed, and turned unto the Lord. Then tidings of these things came unto the ears of the church which was in Jerusalem, and they sent forth Barnabas, that he should go as far as Antioch, who, when he came, and had seen the grace of God, was glad and exhorted them all, that with purpose of heart they would cleave unto the Lord. For he was a good man, and full of the Holy Ghost and of faith, and much people was added unto the Lord." Which is, think about that statement for a minute. Much people was added unto the Lord. You see, a Christian is a member of the body of Christ. Isn't that an interesting statement there? When you are saved, you are added to the Lord. You will become part of his body. Very interesting. And by the way, that's also a good proof of eternal security. All right, the Lord is not in the business of amputating parts of his body. All right, once you are part of the body, you are sealed until the day of redemption. Listen to the other studies on the pre-trib rapture judgment and on also on eternal security. Acts chapter 11, verse 25. "Then departed Barnabas to Tarsus for to seek Saul. And when he had found him, he brought him unto Antioch. And it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people. And the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch." One of the key verses there. And of course, a key verse for you if you are a King James Bible believer, because your King James Bible can be traced back to Antioch. All the other versions are traced back to Alexandria, Egypt. There is no record of Christians going to Alexandria, Egypt and establishing a great work there, which, you know, would have developed, you know, and produced Bibles and things like that. It goes back to Antioch. Very interesting. But as I said earlier, you can see the transition from preaching solely to the Jews to now they're starting to preach Jesus to the Gentiles. And a great number believed and were saved. Again, the doors of witnessing are open there. And the people are gladly receiving the word. They're hearing it. And they're saying, please tell us more. We want to know. Teach us. You know, they assembled with the church, not in the church. Another important passage there. Every little word of your King James Bible is so important. They'd assembled with the church, not in the church. Churches are never a building in your New Testament. Right? It's a group of people. It's Christians. Watch out for that thing, that teaching that the church is a building and it, you know, it's some kind of heresy if you leave it. Right? The church is the body of Christ. But they assembled themselves with the church and they taught much people. People were gladly receiving the word, not only for salvation, but also for instruction in righteousness, for doctrine. Acts chapter 13, we'll jump there. Acts chapter 13, verses 1 through 13, I'll read that. "Now there was in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas and Simeon, that was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manaen, which had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch and Saul. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them. And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. So they, being sent forth by the Holy Ghost, preached unto Seleucia, and from thence they sailed to Cyprus. And when they were at Salamis, they preached the word of God in the synagogues of the Jews, and they had John to their minister. And when they had gone through the isle unto Paphos, they found a certain sorcerer, a false prophet, a Jew, whose name was Bar-Jesus, which was with the deputy of the country, Sergius Paulus, a prudent man, who called for Barnabas and Saul and desired to hear the word of God. Now we're going to start to see here an interesting thing happening. We're going to see a man who is gladly receiving the word, that wants to hear the word of God, but then somebody who says their heart is hardened, they don't want anything to do with hearing the written word of the Lord or hearing the word preached. And you're going to find that if you do some tracting. Sometimes you'll see people that will want to hear it, even with evangelistic tracting where the doors are open. Not everybody's going to be there, that, you know, all the people that are there, they're not all going to want to hear the word preached. But we'll continue here. Acts chapter 13, verse 8. But Elymas the sorcerer, for so is his name by interpretation, withstood them, seeking to turn away the deputy from the faith. Then Saul, who also is called Paul, filled with the Holy Ghost, set his eyes on him and said, O fool of all subtlety and all mischief, thou child of the devil, thou enemy of all righteousness, wilt thou not cease to pervert the right ways of the Lord? And now, behold, the hand of the Lord is upon thee, and thou shalt be blind, not seeing the sun for a season. And immediately there fell on him a mist and a darkness, and he went about seeking someone to lead him by the hand. Then the deputy, when he saw what was done, believed, being astonished at the doctrine of the Lord. So that thing that Paul did to the sorcerer there, it actually led to this man wanting to believe on Jesus Christ. Verse 13, Now when Paul and his company loosed from Paphos, they came to Perga in Pamphylia, and John, departing from them, returned to Jerusalem. So this Sergius Paulus man, he desired to hear the word of the Lord. But the sorcerer, Bar-Jesus, did not want to hear God's word being preached. And it's interesting because Paul preached to the Jews there. If you go through Acts chapter 13, again, I'm not going to read everything, but from verses 14 through 43, Paul is preaching to the Jews. But now look what happens in verse 44 through 52. Actually, we'll start at verse 42. Now when the Jews were gone out of the synagogue, the Gentiles besought that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. Okay, the Gentiles were there. They were also listening in on what was going on in the synagogue, the Jewish synagogue, and the Gentiles were saying, please come back. See, that door's open again. They are gladly receiving the word. They want to hear. Verse 43. Now when the congregation was broken up, many of the Jews and religious proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas, who speaking to them persuaded them to continue in the grace of God. So it wasn't that it was just the Gentiles that were for Paul and Barnabas, it was also some of the Jews. But continuing here, verse 44, here's where it gets interesting. And the next Sabbath day came almost the whole city together to hear the word of God. Almost the whole city came out. Verse 45, But when the Jews saw the multitudes, they were filled with envy, and spake against those things which were spoken by Paul, contradicting and blaspheming. Did you know that there are churches out there, you know, organized religion, that are attracted to big crowds of people? And if they see a Bible believer attracting a large crowd, or even sometimes a small crowd, they get very envious, very jealous. You see, because the big religion, organized religion, is dead. It's spiritually dead. I mean, try listening to a sermon, if you call it a sermon, by the Pope sometime, or by some Greek Orthodox priest. Oh, man, I mean, there's nothing duller in this entire world than listening to those guys. Why? Well, because they're spiritually dead and trying to preach the Word of God, and there's no Holy Spirit in them. You know, they'll stand there and they'll say, "Then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said it was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you." That's how they'll preach. It's horrible. And so these people were used to hearing that, and all of a sudden Paul and Barnabas come. And I don't mean they were putting on a show or anything, but they could tell, hey, these guys have the Holy Spirit in them. And they wanted to come and hear them. The doors, the evangelistic doors were open. They wanted to hear. They wanted to be saved. And the religious leaders in that area saw that large group and they were filled with envy. And they began to contradict and blaspheme. Now look at verse 46. Then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said, "It was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you." See, they had their chance. They had heard the gospel preached. But continuing here, "But seeing ye put it from you, and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, lo, we turn to the Gentiles. For so hath the Lord commanded us, saying, I have set thee to be a light of the Gentiles, that thou shouldest be for salvation unto the ends of the earth. And when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and glorified the word of the Lord." That's interesting. "And as many as were ordained, and as many as were ordained to eternal life believed, and the word of the Lord was published throughout all the region. But the Jews stirred up the devout and honorable women and the chief men of the city, and raised persecution against Paul and Barnabas, and expelled them out of their coasts. But they shook off the dust of their feet against them, and came unto Iconium, and the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Ghost." Wow. Quite a few points I want to make here in this passage of Scripture. Verse 42, the Gentiles wanted to be preached to. Again, you see that the doors were open. It's kind of like you go to downtown Philadelphia or to Hollywood or, you know, one of these places here in America, and you say, "I'm here to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ." How big of a crowd do you think you're going to get? Well, not very big. You know, you're probably going to get the police coming, more than likely. Or you can, you know, try to preach in London or something over there in the UK, or in any of the cities in Australia or up in Canada. The people really don't want to hear. But how about you go to a poor country? How about you go to communist China and you stand up and you say, "I want to tell you people about Jesus Christ." Well, you're probably going to get the police called on you there too, but you're going to end up in a forced labor camp making products for Walmart or something. But the point is, you would have a crowd of people. They'd probably take you aside and say, "Oh, you know, don't preach out in the open here. Come to us and preach to us." And of course, there are many stories of Christians going over there to China, and the people are just anxious. They just want to hear the word of the Lord. And that's what was going on there in Acts chapter 13. But another point, verse 43, some of the Jews also desired to hear in Paul, to hear Paul and Barnabas again. So it wasn't all just Gentiles. Verse 44 says about the whole city came out to hear him. But verse 45 talks about the lost religious Jews were jealous of the big crowd. I went over that already. And they did their best to stop the Lord's work. And again, you'll see that. It's kind of a sad fact, but the reality of it is that most of the time, if you are a Bible-believing Christian, your very worst enemies, the ones that will fight you the hardest, are those that are part of organized religion. Catholics, Greek Orthodox, and many of the bigger Protestant sects as well. You'll have those people, they get jealous, and they will fight against you. They will call the law on you. Verse 46 talks about Paul and Barnabas explaining that they had already heard the gospel and now they were accountable. If you know the verses there, "It was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you, but seeing ye put it from you and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, lo, we turn to the Gentiles." So now you see that transition where now it's no longer just solely to the Jews. Now, you know, in Acts chapter 11, they were starting to go to the Grecians. But now he's actually saying, "We are turning totally from you, and we are going to the Gentiles now. We're going to preach to them." But notice he doesn't say, "You people don't know any better." He doesn't say that. He says it was first spoken to you. So these Jews that were contradicting and blaspheming, they had had the gospel presented to them and they rejected it. Now that's very important because that's going to be part of this, what's coming up here, the accountability tracting. Verse 48, notice that the Gentiles, it says they were glad and glorified the word of the Lord. It doesn't say they were glad and glorified Paul and Barnabas. One of the marks of a true minister is that people will not glorify him, they will glorify the word of the Lord that's preached through him. All right? Don't ever put me up on a pedestal and think that I'm something special. I'm not. I read from the word of God, the King James Bible. You exalt and uplift this book. As a result, God's word was published. Okay, now that means published there, the word does not necessarily mean written, you know, put into tract form and published. You know, you think of publishing books. It means that it was spoken throughout the whole region. But there, I'm not trying to say that, you know, written tracts are bad. They are very, very good. We have the technology now to be able to produce tracts even on our own. I've written a few tracts, and you know, you can make some fairly inexpensive tracks. I do have some on my website there at KingJamesVideoMinistries.com that you can print out and, you know, make your own little gospel tracks. But the fact of the matter is that they, when the Word of God is exalted, when it's lifted up, then the people feel confident, hey, we have the Word of God. And so they go out and they speak the Word of God to other people. And we can also today, we can print it in the form of gospel tracts to get people saved. So, but continuing on here, verse 50 says, but the Jews stirred up the devout and honorable women and the chief men of the city and raised persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them out of their coasts. It's interesting because in the book of James, which I believe is written, directed mostly at tribulation saints, particularly Jews, you know, it's written to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. It says, do not rich men oppress you and, you know, draw you before the judgment seats and things. Yeah. Again, your two biggest enemies as a Bible-believing Christian are number one, religious leaders, organized religious leaders, and number two, the rich. Rich people that don't like to be disturbed. You know, we used to do tracting, quite a bit of tracting. I'm going to talk about this in a few minutes. But we went to, occasionally, we went to rich places and we just quit because it was usually, you know, people came out and threatened us and stuff. So we would go to trailer parks and into inner towns and things and cities because those are the people that are going to be more apt to hear. But the Jews went and they stirred up the devout people, the women and the rich women and the rich men, and said, oh, you don't want these crude, you know, vulgar, you know, Bible thumpers in here. You know, you've got to get them out of here. They're stirring up trouble. You know, yeah, happens today too. But it's interesting there in verse 51, it says, but they shook off the dust of their feet against them and came unto Iconium. Now, what's that all about? Well, Luke chapter 9, verse 1 says, then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority. Excuse me, I gotta turn the page here. Power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases. And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. Now, this is not, again, this is, you know, before the crucifixion. So they are preaching the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, two different kingdoms. And Jesus is sending them out. So it's not quite the same as today, but you can see a tie in here to what's said in Luke chapter 9, verse 5, to what Paul and Barnabas did there. But it says here, Luke chapter 9, verse 3, and he said unto them, take nothing for your journey, neither staves, nor scrip, nor bread, or neither bread, neither money, neither have two coats apiece. And whatsoever house ye enter into, there abide and thence depart. And whosoever will not receive you, when ye go out of that city, shake off the very dust from your feet for a testimony against them. And they departed and went through the towns, preaching the gospel and healing everywhere. Now these verses, of course, as I said, doctrinally, no, they're not specifically directed at a Christian today, but for instruction in righteousness, yeah, there is something there to that. Especially the part about when you go into a city and they don't receive you, you shake the dust off of your feet and leave. Okay, that's what we're going to, what's going to lead us here into the next section. Now, we first started out talking about evangelistic tracting. When you go to a place and they are ready to receive the word of God, they are open, they're saying, please come preach to us. Your mission at that point is to get those tracts out. Now, you're going to find some people that are not, that don't want anything to do with the Lord, that even in the midst of a poor country, you're still going to find Christ rejecting sinners. But a lot of the people are going to want to hear. And even a Christ rejecting sinner, a lot of times in those areas, they'll still take a tract and say thank you. But what happens when you go to a place, to a city, so to speak, and they don't want anything to do with the Lord, and they get mad, they're threatening you, they're calling, I'm going to call the police on you, get the blankety blank out of here, you bling, and they're yelling at you and everything. Do you just keep on going back and going back, and they call the police, and you go through arguments with the police, and you go through court dates and everything else, and you fight it out with the police in court so you can go back and witness to these same people? Is that what you do? No. Not according to Scripture. So what happens when you're in an area that is not readily receiving the Word of God? You say, well, then you don't do any tracting at all. I didn't say that either. No, I think that you should tract in an area, but here you run into what I call accountability tracting, where you're not really giving out gospel tracts expecting, you know, you're seeing the people are hard-hearted and they're saying, you know, get out of here. And so, not a perpetual thing where you keep going back and going back and going back, but you give people tracts and they say, oh, you know, I don't want to talk about it. Well, here you go. That's it. And you walk away. Okay. What is going on there? Well, you're making them accountable. They can't stand before God and say, nobody ever warned me. Nobody ever told me about hell. Nobody ever told me I had to get saved. No, now they're accountable. And if you're in an area, like I said, most of the countries, the English-speaking world right now is pretty much cut themselves off from wanting to be witnessed to. You know, the doors of the gospel are being slammed shut. And if you go door to door, you're, you know, going to actually have a, you know, literal door slamming shut a lot of times in your face. But it's still important to track those people to make sure that they are accountable. Even though the doors of evangelism are closing, those people still need to be held accountable. So let's continue here. But I want to show you something, and this is interesting. Now here's where it gets a little bit tricky with accountability tracting. There are times and places that yes, you should tract, you should put tracts down, even knowing that it's probably not going to win anybody to the Lord. They're probably not going to get saved. You know, your people aren't just coming up to you and, please, can I have a gospel tract? You still need to tract at that point. But there are times and places where those areas have been tracted so hard where the Lord is going to say to you, hey, I don't want you going there. You say, I don't think the Lord would do that. I don't think the Lord would ever make it a thing where you're not allowed to go into an area and preach. Would he? Acts chapter 16, verses 1 through 7. Then came he to Derbe and Lystra, and behold, a certain disciple was there named Timotheus. Books of Timothy, it's who it's written to. The son of a certain woman who was a Jewess and believed, but his father was a Greek. Got a mixed marriage there. And of course, the Jews were, you read back through the Old Testament, they were very much against intermarrying with other races. Acts chapter 16, verse 2, which was well reported of by the brethren that were at Lystra and Iconium. Him would Paul have to go forth with him, and took and circumcised him because of the Jews which were in those quarters. For they knew all that his father was a Greek. And as they went through the cities, they delivered them the decrees for to keep, that were ordained of the apostles and elders which were at Jerusalem. And so were the churches established in the faith, and increased in number daily. Now when they had gone throughout Phrygia and the region of Galatia, and were forbidden of the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia, after they were come to Mysia, they essayed to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit suffered them not. Now your King James Bible uses the word suffer a lot of times for kind of like our modern day allow. So the Spirit allowed them not. is what's going on there. The Spirit suffered them not. So you see two different places there. The Holy Ghost says, I don't want you going into Asia. And then they try to go into Bithynia, and the Spirit suffered them not. So don't go in there either. Now here's the tricky thing. When you go into an area and you see that the doors of evangelism are really pretty much closed, and you say, yeah, but I still want to track. You never know. You might get that one person that does have some questions. They might get saved. But mostly, I just want to make these people accountable. At that point in time, you're going to have to be open to the fact that maybe the Lord might not want you to track that area. You say, well, what are you talking about? You know, you should always do tracting. Well, let me give you a couple examples. There was a big mega church in this area, and we decided that we would put some tracts about, you know, false conversion, make sure that people are, you know, not just, I mean, most of the people that go to these huge, big rock and roll mega entertainment centers, I believe most of them are lost. And so we put in some tracts about salvation, about true salvation, coming to God as a sinner, you know, denying yourself repentance, denying yourself, believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. And we also put in some stuff about Christian rock, as well as the Bible versions. Because if you don't have the Word of God, you know, you're really not going to amount to anything as a Christian. And we put them in there, in these track packs, and we were going to go put them on windshields. And I remember, we had planned to do this thing, and so we went the one time, and it started the freezing rain on the way, and we couldn't continue. It was getting really dangerous, very slippery, so we had to turn around and go home. We tried another week, I think a week or two later, got there, and the services were canceled for that evening. You know, they had some other thing come up or whatever. And we went back another time, and something else went wrong, and it was like, I mean, it was like three or four times we tried to go and track this place, and it just didn't work. And finally, we just kept on forcing it and forcing it and forcing it. We got there, and we were barely got any of the vehicles done. The security came out, told us we had to leave, you know, we're threatening to call the police and whatever else. And, you know, I said, well, there's no signs up saying we couldn't track the vehicles. Well, blah, I need your name and address, and blah, blah, blah. I said, you're not getting it, you know. I mean, we had to leave. And, you know, we were going home, and we were talking, and it was just like, you know, I don't think that, you know, the Lord wanted us to even be there. And I think that the Lord put up some major stop signs. I think that these people have crossed the line with the Lord. They've probably, a lot of them, they've heard. And they, you know, this mega church openly makes fun of traditional churches. And, you know, it's not that they're ignorant. You know, they specifically, the people that go there have left traditional Bible-believing churches, a lot of them. I know of a couple people that go there that are like that. And they go there now to be entertained, you know, to go through the snack bar, you know, and get your food and go in and hear some rock music and hear a little short 5-minute sermon or something, you know. And just a flesh center. So I don't think the Lord wanted us to go there. Give you another example here. The first couple years that we were together as a church, our little house church here, Bible Believers Fellowship, we were putting together things that we called tract packs. I made a video about that. That's on YouTube showing what all was in our tract pack. Again, we put a video in there, a DVD about evolution. We put in some stuff about Bible versions. We put in salvation tracts, a tract about hell, you know, some good stuff. And then we had it in a little bag that had a hole in it that you could hang it on somebody's, you know, doorknob. And, I mean, we put out over 3,000 of these things. And, you know, it was a couple hours every Saturday. We were going out and just tracting and tracting and tracting and tracting. And you know how many replies we got? Two. And they were both from Christians. People saying, oh, you know, I see you offer here more information. You know, we kind of like to have some more information. That's all we got. And, you know, it kind of started occurring to me as we were doing this thing. And, I mean, we were spending a lot of money. We were spending hundreds of dollars on these tracks and materials. And I remember the one time we went out to this one apartment complex, and you know, we were hanging these bags on the doors, and we got down a little ways, and we looked back, and this guy comes out this door, and he grabs the track pack off of his doorknob, didn't even look to see what it was, and he walks over. There's a dumpster out in the parking lot, in the one end of the parking lot, and he goes over, lifts the door, the lid of the dumpster, and blam, throws the track pack in, slams the lid of the thing, and walks back in and slams his door to his apartment. And I thought, you know, okay, I guess the guy's accountable, but he didn't even see what it was. I mean, he didn't even take time to look at the thing. And there went a couple dollars, you know. And it started to occur to me, you know, maybe we need to rethink some of our strategy here. I mean, there comes a point where you're casting your pearls before swine, you know, as the Bible warns about. You know, you're just wasting your time with these people. And I'll get more into that as we continue. Another time we tracted two Catholic church parking lots, and it actually was put in the paper that this was a hate crime. You know, whatever, it wasn't a hate crime. We were just pointing out some problems with the Catholic Church. But again, what was really accomplished by that? How many conversions did we get? Well, I have no idea. I don't even know if anybody read it. More than likely, you know, some of those people probably felt more secure in their Catholic faith because they thought that they were being persecuted for righteousness' sake. They thought, oh, we've been persecuted. We've had a hate crime committed against us. That proves that we're right. See, it can lead to that too. And as I said earlier, we were starting to, you know, kind of go through this thing of attracting, and we started to realize, you know, is this really effective? You know, because I do believe that there should be some fruit to a ministry. You know, when you're doing something for the Lord, I think that there should be some. I mean, those verses that we went through here in the book of Acts, you see that there was some fruit coming from that. But when they had the Jews, the organized religion leaders going out and stirring up the people and kicking them out of the cities, they left. They didn't say, hey, you know, we're going to stay here. We're going to fight this thing out in the courts, you know, to give us a right to stay here and minister to people that don't want to be ministered to. They didn't do that. When they found that there were people that, hey, they don't want to listen to us, they shake off the dust of their feet and they go somewhere else. And so we started to really consider it. We started to talk about it. And at the time, I think I had my website, the KingJamesVideoMinistries.com. I was doing some stuff for YouTube. But we had no sermon audio account. We had no house church account. And they started to push, you know, some of the people in the church started to push, hey, you know, maybe we ought to record our sermons and put them online. And I balked at the idea. I was like, you know, I don't need to do something else like that. You know, it's going to be another thing, you know, and all that. No, we got to do it. We got to do it. Come on, Brian. We got to do it. So I reluctantly gave into the thing. And at first it was a lot of responsibility. And I didn't really appreciate all the responsibility, but I just thought to myself, and I prayed and I said, okay, Lord, if this is what you want us to do, if this is the ministry, because, you know, we were still doing tracting at that point, and I was like, which one is it, Lord? You know, which one do you want us to do? I can't keep doing both here. It's too much work to do both of these things. It's costing us hundreds of dollars to go out and provide these people that were putting tracks out. They're throwing our tracks away, most of them. And we're not seeing any fruit at all from this ministry. And so if you want us to be online, then I pray that you show us some spiritual fruit there. And I don't mean money or fame or anything like that. Don't get me wrong. I mean, I want to see people being helped through this ministry. And I was fully prepared. I was like, you know what? If it goes for a while and we don't see any people downloading our sermons or whatever, I'm done with it. I'm not going to mess with it. But what has happened is the Lord has just opened the doors big time, and we have seen just an incredible response to the preaching ministry here at Bible Believers Fellowship. We've seen a lot of people getting onto the websites, and I get emails from people all the time thanking me for the work that I'm doing, and people saying, I never understood this before. You've helped me to understand it. And so the Lord bore witness. He allowed spiritual fruit to come from this ministry. And you say, well, then you quit tracting. No, not entirely. We still do tracting on our own, in our own personal time. We go out into the out to go shopping, run errands, go get gas for the vehicle, whatever. We'll still take tracks out. We still witness to people. But the concerted effort of going and taking boxes full of expensive tracks and go and hang them on doors or go knocking on doors, we just don't do that anymore. We don't have the money. We don't have the time. We're so active in online ministry now, and the Lord is blessing that ministry. But I want to say something else here quick, and that is be very careful if you, when you do go out and you tract, be very careful about where you're laying these tracks. I remember hearing a story the one time a sister was telling me, how that they had laid a chick tract. They went into like a McDonald's or something like that, and they laid it up right on the area where that has the ketchup and the mustard and all that, you know, the salt and the pepper and whatever else. They laid it right there, and they said that they saw an employee come over and take it, and just about 2 feet away from where they were standing was a trash can. And they just took the track and boom, right into the trash. Don't put your tracks in areas where it's easy for somebody to throw it out. We have a local Walmart here, and we know a woman that works there, and she laughs about how that the employees go around, and they, whenever they see a chick track, they'll take it. And they take it back to the break room, and people look at them or whatever, and then throw them out. And they're used to doing that. They're used to going around looking for chick tracks and throwing them out. See? Well, what's going on there? Well, you're wasting your time. Nobody's really getting converted there. You know, well, you might have a chance at one of the employees. Yeah, sure, but, you know, how many people in a store are going to want to take a gospel tract that's laying there and put it in their pocket when they know that they're being surveilled with the cameras? See, that's stuff that you have to think about. You know, you don't want to look like you're stealing anything. And, you know, there again, a lot of times if you want to do an experiment, you can see this. Go to some big store and put a tract out in the open where everybody can see it, and people walk by it like it's invisible. Why? Well, because people are very prideful. They don't want to go and stop and pick up a gospel tract and stand there and read it in front of everybody. See, and that's another thing I want to talk about here quickly, and that is that the atmosphere has changed. People are changing, and you have to realize that and admit to it. We can't say, you know, I refuse to change with the times, you know. Well, you shouldn't compromise. You shouldn't conform to the world. But you have to understand that people's minds are changing. We were talking about this this past Sunday, and one of the brethren here was saying that he knew a guy, an older man, that he had gone out door to door for many, many, many years. And he said, you go back to the 1970s and on back, and he said, you'd go up to people's doors and you'd knock on the door, and they'd come to the door and they'd say, hey, come on in, you know, and they'd sit down with you and you know, listen to you and everything. And he said, in the 1980s, things started to change. People didn't invite them in as much. Now, maybe it still happens some places, but I know around here, all the door-to-door stuff I ever did, we were never once invited into anyone's home. And I would say probably 90% of the people that we knocked on their door, they came to the front door with a frightened look on their face. Why? Well, because people have become electronic. People are tied to the internet. They want to be, they associate with other people online. And when you actually, go out in public sometime and try to strike up a conversation with somebody. Most of them act like you're some kind of two-headed monster if you start talking to them. I mean, I've talked to people. I've tried to talk to young people out in public. Just, hey, how you doing? You know, well, it's a nice day out there and whatever. And they act like they're scared to death of you. See, things are changing. Times are changing. And that's why I believe online ministry is such an important area now, such an important field. That's where you can really get a lot done for the Lord. And again, you know, I'm very traditional. I have a lot of, you know, woodworking tools and things that are non-electric. I am very much attracted to the old ways of doing things and old-time evangelism and all that. But I have to admit, times have changed. And to go door-to-door, Most people are going to be afraid of you when you come up to the door. They're not going to invite you in there, and they want to do whatever they can to get rid of you as quickly as possible. They'll just, you know, yeah, okay, well, I'm not interested, I'm sorry. And then, boom, they shut the door. You know, a lot of times, I remember there were times we would go to a door, knock on the door like that, and, you know, nobody would come to the door. And then, you know, you'd kind of like look over to the side and you see the window blind kind of pulled to the side and you see somebody looking out. And as soon as they see you looking, you know, they disappear. Like they're in there hiding from you. You know, it's like we're just out trying to, you know, witness here. You know, we're not horrible monsters or something. See, times have changed. And you have to be aware of that. Another little thing I want to talk about here before we continue is the thing and the subject of marked tracks versus unmarked tracks. There again, if you're going out and you're as a church or whatever and you're trying to, you know, invite people to come be part of your fellowship or whatever, you know, use marked tracks, you know, your contact information on it. But when it comes to accountability tracting, if you're going to go to an area where your tracting efforts might not be appreciated and might even be considered as criminal, sometimes there all you want to do is just put the people in contact with the Lord. Maybe have a website on there that has the message of salvation on it. You know that they can go there. It won't tie back to you. I mean, folks, you got to look at this thing prophetically. You got to read your Bible and understand where you are at on the prophetic time scale. Okay, we are not heading into a time of revival and spiritual renewal. We are heading towards apostasy and, in fact, persecution coming upon the Christian church. It's not very far off. But we'll continue here with the study. Don't have a whole lot more to go here. But Acts chapter 16, we'll go there next. Acts chapter 16 through 18. And the question comes up here, what if laws are passed making tracting and or preaching illegal? What do you do then? Okay, it says here, and it came to pass as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. The same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. And this did she many days, but Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out the same hour. Interesting there that a devil-possessed woman, she wasn't interested in salvation, but she knew what Paul was doing. That's an interesting thought. Acts chapter 16, verse 19. And when her masters saw that the hope of their gains was gone, they caught Paul and Silas and drew them into the marketplace unto the rulers and brought them to the magistrates, saying, these men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city. And you'll get that if you're, you know, out trying to do door-to-door stuff sometimes. You'll get this thing. And again, I'm not saying that you should totally not do any door-to-door, totally not do any kind of tracting or whatever. I'm not saying that. I'm just simply saying you have to be aware of, you know, the situation in some places. Verse 21, and teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans. And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates rent off their clothes and commanded to beat them. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely. Who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And, of course, the prison keeper did as well. Verse 26, and suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's bands were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, awaking out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. Of course, he would have killed himself because if it would have been found that all the prisoners escaped on his watch, they would have killed him. So he thought, well, I'll just do the job, you know, get the problem or get my punishment over with. Verse 28. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, Do thyself no harm, for we are all here. Then he called for a light and sprang in, and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas, and brought them out and said, Sirs, what must I do to be saved? Acts chapter 16, verse 31. And they said, Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord, and to all that were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night, and washed their stripes, and was baptized, he and all his, straightway. And when he had brought them into his house, he set meat before them, and rejoiced, believing in God with all his house. So sometimes, the point I want to make here is sometimes a bad tracting experience or street preaching can actually lead to salvation of those that are in authority. And how does that happen, you say? Well, when they see how you react as a Christian. If you're yelling and screaming about your rights being violated and whatever else, you're probably not going to get through to them. But if they see that you have a good attitude in spite of how you've been treated, and, you know, it's going to bring some conviction to them. So even in some situations, you know, where you have accountability tracting, where the people really don't want to hear, even in some of those situations, you know, you should still do it. Again, you have to be open to the Lord's leading in these areas. But I want to show you something interesting here. We'll continue Acts chapter 16, verse 35. And when it was day, the magistrates sent the sergeant, saying, Let those men go. And the keeper of the prison told this, saying to Paul, The magistrates have sent to let you go. Now therefore depart and go in peace. Now look what Paul does. But Paul said unto them, They have beaten us openly, uncondemned, being Romans, and have cast us into prison, and now do they thrust us out privily? Nay, verily, but let them come themselves and fetch us out. And the sergeants told these words unto the magistrates, and they feared when they heard that they were Romans. And they came and besought them, and brought them out, and desired them to depart out of the city. And they went out of the prison and entered into the house of Lydia. And when they had seen the brethren, they comforted them and departed. So the question comes up there, would Paul use something secular like the law to declare his rights? Yeah, he did. And there are times when I think brethren should use the Constitution or the laws that you have in other countries to say, hey, I have a right to do this. You had no right to go there and you know, threaten me or cast me into prison or whatever else. Okay, it doesn't mean that you should just be a little weak jellyfish, a little Christian doormat. Okay, sometimes you need to remind the law that there are laws which they have to abide by. But we'll continue here. Acts chapter 17, verses 1 through 4. Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where was a synagogue of the Jews, and Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and three Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the Scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus, whom I preach unto you, is Christ. And some of them believed, and consorted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks a great multitude, and of the chief women not a few. So you have there again, some of them believed, but then again, some did not. Acts chapter 17, verse 5. But the Jews which believed not, moved with envy, there you have that again, took unto them certain lewd fellows of the baser sort, and gathered a company, and set all the city on an uproar, and assaulted the house of Jason, and sought to bring them out to the people. And when they found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren unto the rulers of the city, crying, That these that have turned the world upside down are come hither also, whom Jason hath received, and these all do contrary to the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, one Jesus. And they troubled the people and the rulers of the city when they heard these things, and when they had taken security of Jason and of the other, they let them go. And the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night unto Berea, who coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews. These were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and searched the Scriptures daily whether those things were so. Therefore many of them believed, also of honorable women, which were Greeks, and of men not a few. But when the Jews of Thessalonica had knowledge that the word of God was preached of Paul at Berea, they came thither also and stirred up the people. And then immediately the brethren sent away Paul to go as it were to the sea, but Silas and Timotheus abode there still. So, if things get too dangerous in your area, you might want to consider ministry somewhere else. Right there again, you see that thing. They didn't just say, well, Paul, you got to stick it out here. You know, they're threatening your life. They're trying to get you in trouble with the law. You just got to stay there and fight it out. Not necessarily. Sometimes you can do that. Sometimes, you know, you might have to go to jail for what you're doing, whatever. Other times, it's best just to go someplace else and minister there. Shake off the dust of your feet and go to the next city. And, of course, you know, we're not going to read all the verses there in Acts chapter 17, but Paul travels to Athens to speak with the pagan philosophers. Acts chapter 17, verse 32. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, and others said, we will hear thee again of this matter. So Paul departed from among them, howbeit certain men clave unto him and believed, among the which was Dionysius the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with them. Again, we see another reaction when witnessing to certain groups. Okay, when you witness to certain people, especially educated pagans, you know, college graduates, we would call them today, secular college graduates, well, even some Christian college graduates, a lot of times they'll mock you. But sometimes you might get somebody that converts. Now, we're going to read one more place here in Scripture, and then we'll be done with this study. Acts chapter 18, verses 1 through 6. After these things, Paul departed from Athens and came to Corinth. You know, the Corinthians, the letters to the Corinthians, you know what their problems were there. And found a certain Jew named Aquila, born in Pontus, lately come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because that Claudius had commanded all Jews to depart from Rome and came unto them. And because he was of the same craft, he abode with them and wrought, for by their occupation they were tent makers. So Paul was making tents along with them while being in ministry. And he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks. And when Silas and Timotheus were come from Macedonia, Paul was pressed in the spirit and testified to the Jews that Jesus was Christ. Remember what he said earlier? He said, I'm going to go to the Gentiles. He'd say, well, then he was done with the Jews. No, not necessarily. He still had that desire to speak to the Jews. See, the evangelism, the evangelistic tracting, the evangelistic witnessing was mostly with the Gentile people at that point, but he still had that accountability tracting, that accountability witnessing that he would do to the Jews. But look at their reaction here. Acts chapter 18, verse 6. And when they opposed themselves and blasphemed, he shook his raiment and said unto them, your blood be upon your own heads. I am clean. From henceforth I will go unto the Gentiles. So, even though he saw that the doors were mostly open for him, you know, the Bible actually calls him the apostle to the Gentiles. Even though those doors were mostly in the Gentile world, he would still occasionally speak to the Jews, and when they oppose themselves, which is really what happens when somebody rejects Jesus Christ, they're actually opposing themselves. They're not rejecting you, they're rejecting Jesus. All right. When they oppose themselves, he said, okay, I'm clean from you. Your blood be upon your own heads. From henceforth I will go unto the Gentiles. Now, that's very instructive. Okay, you need to learn from that as a Christian. What can you learn? Well, the Jews had plenty of chances to receive the Lord Jesus, but they opposed themselves. They rejected. Paul didn't continue to waste his time with these Jews who were openly blaspheming Jesus. He went and searched for open doors. You know, he prayed for that a door would be opened unto me. He talked about that in other places. He went and he looked for places where he could preach and teach. Now, I want to make a couple final points here to consider before we close this study. Point number one, you must be open to the Lord's leading when it comes to witnessing with gospel tracts. All right, if you're going to an area and you're seeing that your tracts are just being thrown out, don't keep going there. All right, you're going to have to learn that thing of saying, these people don't want to hear it. You know, every time I bring tracks in there, you know, and you might even get somebody. I had a brother that was tracting in this one area, and one of the women employees of the store came up to him and they said, "I see what you're doing. We're throwing out all your tracks, and I'm going to report you to the authorities." And he came and he's like, "What am I supposed to do? Should I, you know, should I listen to her?" And I said, "Stop tracting there. You're wasting your time. They're just throwing them out. You know, you're not getting through to anybody there." Point number two, real ministry should bear spiritual fruit. And that doesn't mean that every single tract that you put out should come back and you should hear people getting saved right and left. It, you know, real ministry, there again, the preaching that we do online, the preaching I do online, a lot of the videos, there's a lot of negative responses. Okay, in fact, it's more negative than it is positive. But there is positive spiritual fruit that comes from it. And if you're putting out thousands and thousands of gospel tracts and there's no reaction or just all bad reactions, you might want to consider doing something else for the Lord. Point number three. And here's the one that a lot of the brethren are going to have a hard time with. But it's a fact. Our world has changed. Most people are not open to an evangelist standing at the front door. I know up here in, you know, north, up in Pennsylvania, you're going to get a very cold reception if you go out door to door. Most people just do not want to talk to somebody on their front doorstep. It's just a fact. You have to consider other avenues of ministry, other ways to do it, online or tracting. But be very careful with the tracting there. Be open to the Lord's leading. Point number four. Most people are too embarrassed to read a tract that is out in the open. Okay? You just go and you lay a tract on a bench in the middle of some big shopping store. Most people aren't going to sit there and read the thing. You might get some, but you have to be a little bit more creative nowadays with your tracting. An idea that I would suggest is if you can get little tracts that can be slipped inside of things. A good example would be like you have a big box, a furniture box or something, and it has those little handles on the side, the little holes that, you know, you can pick up the box that way. You can go over and just slip a little tract right in there. That way, the people don't see the tract until they get it home. And then they're in their privacy of their own home. There, you know, they open up the box and, "Oh, what's this?" Nobody's around. They can pick it, you know, they can look at it. It'll start a conversation. That's a lot better of an idea than just putting them out in the open where the employees of the store can see them and throw them in the trash. Don't place tracts, by the way. Another bad thing that I will say, speak against here, don't put them in bathrooms, in big stores and stuff like that. Most people aren't willing to pick up things in bathrooms because they don't know who touched it. You know, a bathroom is kind of an unclean place, especially a public restroom, and most people aren't going to be real quick to pick up a tract in a place like that. Something else to think about. Of course, you know, if you're putting paper tracts outside where they can get wet, you know, a lot of people aren't going to pick up a soggy tract. You know, "But I heard a story where some guy did and he got saved." Yeah, but that's in the minority. Be creative with your tracting. All right, if you're in an area where the people are readily, you know, the evangelistic tracting is there, people want to be evangelized, the doors of the gospel are open, you're not going to have a hard time getting rid of your tracts. In fact, most of the time you're going to have a hard time keeping your tracts in stock. You're going to be giving them out so quick. But if you live in an area where, which most of my listeners do, you live in an area where the doors of the gospel are pretty much shut, the people don't want to hear it, they, "Oh, don't talk to me about that stuff," you're going to have to be a little bit more creative with your tracting. Okay? Point number five. The internet is a great place to witness. There are so many resources, so many good salvation messages, so many good sermons, preaching, teaching of the Word of God. Some really good stuff out there. And there are a lot of opportunities for you to witness. And there again, there are a lot of people that just live on the internet. You try to talk to them face to face. You meet them out in public. They'll act like you're a monster. They won't want to talk. But if you can get to that same person on the internet, they're open a lot of times, and they'll listen. You have to be open to that. Okay? Point number six. I believe it is, yeah. You have to keep in mind that dispensationally speaking, the world is heading into the Great Tribulation. Not the church, but the world. Things are going to change. All right? Again, I've talked about this in other studies, but the fact of the matter is, we are not heading into a time where church buildings are going to be on the increase and everything. In the tribulation time period, the whole world is going to worship the beast, the Antichrist. Where do you worship at? In church buildings. And we're seeing a massive exodus of the true body of Christ. The true Bible-believing Christians are having to leave incorporated churches because the incorporated churches are getting more and more corrupt. And see, it's a bad problem because as they lose members, instead of going back and preaching the word, returning to the old paths, they don't do that. They actually go the opposite direction. They go towards entertainment. They go towards, we'll put movies in, we'll put coffee and donuts in, we'll put worldly dress standards, we'll put worldly music in. We'll give them the world so that we can draw them in here. And a lot of these big church buildings, all they are, they're just lost people trying to worship a god of their own creation. And that's why when you try to speak to these modern Christians and you try to tell them, you know, you can actually quote the words of Jesus, you know, ye are of your father, the devil, and the lusts of your father ye will do. And they'll say, you're not being Christ-like. You know, you gotta love that. I've had that happen a couple times now. You know, you actually quote the verses of, or the words of Jesus Christ, you're a hypocrite, you're a generation of vipers, you know, and they'll say, you're not being Christ-like. Well, what's the problem? Well, they've created their own Christ. They've created their own Jesus that has no basis in Scripture. And that, you know, it's a fact that most modern Christians live totally without reference to the Bible. They form their own beliefs on their feelings. But we'll continue here. Just a couple more points, two more points actually, then we're done. Point number seven. Don't waste time in the wrong ministry or with people who refuse to listen. Okay, don't beat people over the head and, you know, you will get saved. You will, you know, witness to people. Let them know where you stand. If they yell and blaspheme and get out of here, blah, 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 shake off the dust of your feet for a testimony against them. Just simply say, hey, Lord, I tried. I tried to witness to this relative. I tried to witness to this coworker. I tried to witness to this person. They don't want to hear it. And so I put them in your hands, Lord. You take care of them. I'm going to go and I'm going to witness some other place. Okay, I'm going to focus my ministry, the time that I have here on earth, I'm going to focus it somewhere else. And the final point, if the doors of witnessing, if the doors of tracting are closed in your area and you're not seeing any spiritual fruit, maybe you want to still witness. I'm not saying that you should never do tracting in an area. There is the thing of accountability tracting. You're making the people accountable, you know, whatever. But you might want to spend your money sending it over to a foreign mission field, a foreign missionary who lives in an area where there is evangelistic tracting, where the people want to hear. They gladly receive the word. All right, I know that, you know, I'll say his name again, but Brother Lordson Rock over there in India, I wish I had more money that I could, you know, send him more money. I mean, he's getting a lot of work done. And over there in India and in Nepal and some of these other places he's traveled to, those people are a lot more open to the gospel than they are here in America. And instead of me going out and spending a couple hundred dollars on gospel tracts that are just going to get thrown out by, you know, prideful Americans, I'd be a lot better off sending money to a guy like him over there, or people in China, missionaries in China or in the Ukraine or in other places. You know, it'd be a lot better idea to send money for tracks over to them where the people want the tracks than it would be to just keep buying tracks that are just going to get tossed here in America. So those are some things to think about. I'm not trying, by this sermon, I am not trying to discourage anybody from tracting. What I'm trying to do is, I'm trying to help you to be fruitful. I'll give you just one other little story here before we close. The area that I live here, we have a town not too far from here called Brickerville. And the reason it's called that is because this area is known for its red sandstone. We have rocks all over the place here, and they are red. And there were many brick factories in this area that have used the dirt, have used the rocks, you know, some of those, because it's a very red, very heavy clay type of soil. Now, gardening here, there are some plants that will grow and that will produce fruit in this soil. But there's a lot of them that just won't grow. We don't have the right soil for certain types of plants. Now, would it make sense for me to say, well, I don't care about that. I'm going to buy these plants anyhow, and I'm going to put them in, and I am just going to force these plants to grow. No. I should look for plants that will grow, that are compatible with the soil that is here in my local area, so that I can produce more fruit. See? You get my point? My point is, you have to be careful with the soil that's in your area. You have to be open to the ministries that are going to bear the most fruit. All right? It's just something to think about. If you are not seeing much fruit from your tracting efforts, if you are feeling like, you know, boy, maybe I'm wasting my time here, well, then pray and ask the Lord what He would have you spend your time on. Or maybe shift the type of tracting that you're doing. Instead of just laying them out in the open where they can be thrown out, maybe look at some different types of tracts that can be put in boxes, that can be put in places where people will take them into their private home and read them. Be open to the Lord's leading with this thing. Okay? So that's going to be it for this study. Thank you very much for listening. Let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in the word and doctrine. For the scripture saith, Thou shalt not muzzle the ox that treadeth out the corn, and the laborer is worthy of his reward. If these sermons or videos have been a blessing to you, please help us to continue this work by supporting this ministry. You can donate online through PayPal at our website, www.kingjamesvideoministries.com. Thank you, and may the Lord Jesus Christ bless you.